Welcome. Welcome to Meadow United Methodist Church, 768 Summit Road, here in Eden, North Carolina. Today we are celebrating Thanksgiving. I can't believe that Thursday is Thanksgiving Day. And this is just a wonderful time of the year. And we have so much to be thankful for, which we'll talk about in our service today. I would like for you to take your song sheet that I placed at your seat. Stand as you're able. We're going to sing twice. Thank you, Lord. Christmas is just such a busy season of the year. We skip December, and then sometimes the weather turns bad, January, February, March, and it's dark and cold, and we don't meet those months. So we got two more Tuesday nights. Please come and join us. And we have collected $300 with Bingo that we're sending to the Rockingham Council of Bible Education that helps to pay the benefits for the Bible teachers at the high schools and the middle schools. And last year we collected $200, so we've got more people that's been coming lately, and we got more money. So I'll get that in the mail today. I gave Diane cash, and she gave me a check from the church. I'll get that in the mail today to the Rockingham Council of Bible Education. We need bingo prizes for the nursing home. Our blood drive is November 28th. It will be held at Spray United Methodist Church. People can register online. Now, most of you cannot give, I know, but you might know somebody that could give. And then we're looking for 20 units. Right now we've got about 10 people signed up. So we need some more people to sign up from our community. Pray for the country of Ukraine. It's awful. You already know that. We're collecting canned foods for the Spray Food Pantry. They give out food once a month. I check the funeral homes daily to see who's there, maybe to make sure my name's not there, who knows. But anyway, I noticed two people there that we're connected with in some ways. Kemp Nichols is the owner of Bateman's Florist, Bateman's Flowers, and she passed away in Winston-Salem this week. Arlen Bunch passed away at hospice. Arlen was the assistant principal at Holmes Middle School for a number of years, and he was the principal at some other places, and he was probably a coach and a teacher and so forth. So anyway, two people I just wanted to lift up and make you aware of. We contributed 11 shoeboxes. We actually physically had 10 shoeboxes, and Peggy did a shoebox online. So that made our 11th one. So I took those over to First Presbyterian Church, and they were excited to see us, as they always are. And they'll be headed on their way to wherever they're going, probably Charlotte. If they haven't left, they may be going tomorrow. Of course, today we celebrate Thanksgiving. If any of you are free Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, we're going to decorate the church. Now, I know I've already started up here just a little bit. If you want to get a, you can get a medium-sized poinsettia at Walmart for $5 that looks pretty. These were 13. If you want to get one and simply bring it, in a couple of weeks I'll do a list of who donated flowers. I have not checked with T&G Greenhouse this year. Prices are constantly going up, and what's at Walmart is pretty and it's inexpensive. So I'll try and get that on our contact source for the church, so that others will know if they would like to participate in that. Any other announcements this morning? You have any birthdays? Anniversaries? Let us stand as we're able, turning your hymn book to 61, I changed it, 61, and we'll sing number 61.
Of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
You may be seated. If you'll turn in your hymn book, please, to 694. and Kathy, I'm sorry, I got mixed up earlier. I looked at it wrong. Anyway, 694. In 1863, that President Lincoln declared Thanksgiving a national holiday. So I thought that was kind of interesting. Originally, Thanksgiving wasn't even in November. It was in October. So things do change. President Franklin D. Roosevelt moved Thanksgiving in 1939. Thanksgiving leftovers led to the very first ever TV dinners. Swanson Food made lots and lots and lots, tons of turkey. And people ate on Thanksgiving. The next day they had a tremendous amount of turkey left over. In fact, they had 260 tons of leftover turkey. Diane makes a lot of turkeys and works a lot of turkeys. So not 260 tons though, thank goodness. They used 5,000 aluminum trays. They had an assembly line of hand packers. The turkey with the cornbread dressing, the gravy, the peas, the sweet potatoes, it sold for 98 cents back when they did that. And that was the first year of production, and that year they sold 10 million of those dinners. So, that's something interesting about Thanksgiving again. The menu for the first Thanksgiving in Plymouth back in 1621, it included lobster, seal, and swans. An interesting combination of food for those early pilgrims, along with some other things too. They probably did shoot a turkey or two. Pumpkin pie has long been a favorite, but it's not America's favorite pie. Pumpkin pie is America's second favorite pie. What do you think the number one pie is?
Apple.
Yes, it's apple pie. So that would be my favorite too. Female turkeys don't gobble. I didn't know that. Only males gobble. Okay, that's pretty much some of the interesting facts I ran across. And certainly, Thanksgiving is a wonderful day or time of year to say thank you. And we can say thank you in a lot of different ways. You know, we can say, you know, thank you for all the hard work that you do. Or thanks for having my back. Please accept my deepest gratitude. I have to give credit when it's due. This has been such a blessing. That's so kind of you. Much appreciated. Thank you for taking the time to do this. Your support means the world. I'm beyond grateful. I sincerely applaud you. I'm forever indebted. I stand in recognition. Thanks in advance. And of course, that's just what we might say here in the United States. If we were at some other places around the world, we would say thank you a little bit different. My pages are sticking together. We might say gracias if we spoke Spanish, or Shukran in standard Arabic. Merci or merci beaucoup in French for thank you very much. Russian, kribal, thank you. Two or three others. In German, danke, or danke schön, thank you very much. In Turkish, çeşka, idaman, thank you. And, you know, we can go from one country to another. Italian, grazie, molto grazie, grazie miao. So anyway, sometime this week, Thursday especially, but other days too, think about people that you can thank. It's a wonderful day to say thank you. Well, I threw away my program. Nick, how about bring me one off the front ditch over there? Another one. What did you do? I guess I ate. I'm hungry. Okay. How has God blessed you this week? He blessed us. We had plumbing problems. We got it fixed. We had no heat upstairs on the second level of the house. So Bruce came and fixed that. So we're blessed to get repairs done. I hate to look at the bills when they pile in, but anyway, it's a blessing to need something done and get people to come and do a good job of fixing it. Other blessings.
Brother Wayne, this little song sheet, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. I don't believe there's a greater blessing than that.
Amen.
That is a wonderful blessing.
It absolutely is. And
he died for us. He paid our sin debt.
And we wish that every single person could say that line, that he's provided salvation for them. Absolutely. Others. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. So we go to the Lord in prayer. We have many that we want to lift up. The Tabitha Godwin, our nation, David Moore, people not here today, our schools, Rhonda Chapman, Donna Sims, Shirley Stevens, Karen Johnson, country of Ukraine, Peggy Kendrick, Denise Wentz, Lois Kezard, Dwayne Jeffries, Marie Brooks, Carol Griffin, Barney McBride, Luann Joyce, Kay Price, UNC Rockingham Rehab, Bill Abisky's family, Sherry and Chad, Silva Baya, Deborah Finney, Bill Abisky, and then Bill called me this morning, said he just didn't feel like being here today. Betty Finney, who's at hospice, Ricky Hall, Cindy Bolding, Joe Bolding, Betty Booth, Ann Griffin, Lori Nelson, this is a friend of Carol's, Kim Nichols family, Arlen Bunch family. Do we have updates or others that we need to add to our list?
Wayne, add the Josh Pruitt family.
This is which Pruitt?
Josh Pruitt
Josh,
family.
Okay.
This is a young man, 22 years old. Left here too early. I've taught him. I've taught his one of his stepsisters. I've taught a couple of his cousins. So it's a big extended family. And a big
okay,
house.
So we need to lift the family up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Others. Let us pause for our meditation and our prayers. Dear Father, we come to you today so weak, knowing the only direction that we can turn is to you. Lord, be with those that are sick. Remove their pain. Promote healing in their body if that's within your will. Help them to be able to regain their livelihood, being able to do things that they want to do. Be with those taking care of them. Lord, be with those that are grieving this day. Bring them peace and comfort. Help them to hold on to their good memories and be able to remember that as Christians that we will meet our loved ones one day. Lord, be with those that are struggling with all kind of needs. Help them to find resolution to whatever their need and problem might be. Lord, bless this church. Help us to reach out among ourselves and others. Help us to let people know that they're important. We care about them, we love them. Help us, Lord, to have the courage, the wisdom, the ability to provide care and love that you so generously share with others. Lord, be with our country. Our country's a mess. Help us to be able to return to be a nation under God, a nation that protects our rights and our privileges. Bring justice to our land. Lord, bless our service today. Thank you for all of the thanksgivings that have been a part of the past, and help us to be able to continue in the future to give thanks for so much, because we owe all good things to you. Lead and guide us, Father, for we ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Our responsive reading is found on page 795 and 796. We're reading from Psalm 72. Please join with me. Give the king your justice, O God,
and your righteousness to the royal son.
May he judge your people with righteousness,
and your poor with justice.
Let the mountains bear prosperity for the people, and the hills in righteousness.
May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor.
May he live while the sun endures, and as long as the moon throughout all generations.
May he be like rain that falls on the mown grass, like showers that water the earth.
In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound till the moon be no more.
May he have dominion from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth.
May his foes bow down before him and his enemies lick the dust. May the kings of Tarshish and of the Isles render him tribute. May the kings of Sheba and Sheba bring gifts.
May all kings fall down before him. And all nations serve him.
For he delivers the needy when they call, the poor and those who have no helper.
He has pity on the weak and the needy,
and saves the lives of the needy.
From oppression and violence he redeems their life, and precious is their blood in his sight.
Long may he live. May gold of Sheba be given to him. May prayer be made for him continually, and blessings invoked for him all the day.
May there be abundance of grain in the land. May it wave on the tops of the mountains. May its fruits be like Lebanon.
And may thy blossom forth in the cities like the grass of the field.
May his name endure forever. His fame continue as long as the sun. May people bless themselves by him. All nations call him blessed.
Recently passing the plate again, and we're thankful for that, and we're very fortunate as a church to be able to pay all of our bills, and we're thankful for that. Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
For our special music today, I'm going to play a CD by Ray Bolts. It's entitled Thank You. We've heard it before. This is very appropriate for this Thanksgiving service.
Change. Thank you. There were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around.
Made a difference. I can, you know, of course, for most people like myself, mom and dad certainly influenced and made a difference in my life. But I can think about Archie Daniels, the county manager for Rockingham County, was my mentor when I was making speeches and speech contests all over the place. And my one piano teacher stood out more than the others did, and a seventh grade teacher just did such different things that impressed the students and lifted us up and encouraged us to do our very best. And he was a role model for me as I became a teacher and so forth. So some of these people we can't thank other than just, you know, through the Lord, we can thank them. But there may be some that are still alive that we could write a short note to and just say, hey, thank you for making a difference. Think about the possibility for being able to do that this week. I was over at Deborah's funeral recently, along with some of you, and one of my former students came up and said that I made a difference in his life. That if I hadn't taken the interest in him and helped him along in the sixth grade, he said I probably would have been in jail by now. So we never know what difference we might make in somebody's life. So again, you know, reach out and thank people if you can. Our scripture today comes from Luke, chapter 22, verses 7 through 20. I'm reading from the King James Version. Again, Luke chapter 22, beginning with verse 7. Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, Go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat. And they said unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, Behold, when you are entered into the city, there should be a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water, following him into the house, where he entered in. And you shall say unto the good men of the house, The master saith unto thee, Where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room, furnished, there make ready. And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not eat any more food thereof until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup, and gave thanks, and said, Take this, and divide it among yourselves. And I said unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread, and gave thanks, and brake it, and gave unto them, saying, This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Anyone studying the life of Jesus, our Lord, will discover that he practiced holy habits. For example, he habitually went to worship either in the temple or the synagogue. On the Sabbath, you knew exactly where you're going to find him. He also must have read the scriptures, which at that time was just the Old Testament. He knew the scriptures well. He quoted them frequently. He obviously made a habit of studying them. And he also practiced the holy habit of putting his faith into action. Call it the holy habit of service. Thus we see him feeding the hungry, ministering to the sick, the lonely, ministering to anybody that he saw in need. Jesus also practiced the holy habits of giving, of working, and especially the holy habit of praying and giving thanks to God. In our scripture reading of the day, we find Jesus in the upper room with his friends, his disciples. They're about to eat, but before they broke bread, what did Jesus do? He practiced the holy habit of thanksgiving. St. Luke writes, And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them. Why do you think it was so important to Jesus to offer gratitude to God the Father? Because Jesus knew, and he wanted everyone else to know that every good gift comes from the hand of our loving Creator. As far as offering thanks before meals was concerned, Jesus wanted us to remember what Malby Babcock put into these words, Back of the loaf is the snowy flour, and back of the flour the meal, and back of the meal is the wheat and the sower, and the Son and the Father's will, all of which is to say that the source of our daily bread is our Father God. While Jesus thanked God regularly, as we should, it's nonetheless a wonderful thing that we've set aside one day a year to spend time being grateful, not only for another abundant harvest, but for all the gifts from the Father's unfailing hand. As the late columnist Sidney Harris once put it, Thanksgiving reminds us of how much we owe to forces outside of ourselves, and how much all of us, regardless of station, are in the hands of Providence. On Thanksgiving Day, then, we should pause to recall that we are indeed in the hands of Providence. We are in the caring hands of someone that never forgets us and who provides for us in ways that are too numerous to mention. That is what the pilgrims wished to acknowledge when they celebrated their first Thanksgiving Day so long ago. Here's what William Bradford, one of their leaders, wrote when he proclaimed a day of celebration and thanksgiving, and I quote, "Inasmuch as the Great Father has given us this year an abundant harvest of Indian corn, wheat, peas, beans, squash, and garden vegetables, and has made the forest abound with game and the sea with fish and clams, and inasmuch as he has protected us from the ravages of the savages, and has spared us from pestilence and disease, has granted us to worship him according to the dictates of our own conscience. Now I, your magistrate, do proclaim that all ye pilgrims do gather at the meeting house to render thanks to Almighty God for all his blessings." Unquote. To celebrate true Thanksgiving is to get everything into proper perspective. It is to admit that ultimately we are not self-sufficient, but totally dependent upon the grace of God. It's said that Martin Luther's last words from the pulpit were these: "We are all beggars, that is for sure. If we believe that God is the creator and the owner of all earth, then we are in a sense beggars indeed. That is to say that ultimately we own nothing. We leave this earth with empty hands. And all that we have even now is really owned by God and given to us to use as good stewards if we would but acknowledge it."
Amen.
Thanksgiving Day offers us an opportunity to stop and express our appreciation for the preciousness of life, the goodness of life, the deliciousness of life's bounty given to us by God, good measure, pressed down, and running over. To develop the holy habit of thanksgiving, one must practice having the gratitude or attitude of gratitude. To say it requires us constantly being grateful for every blessing of life. One thinks of St. Francis of Assisi, sitting with a fellow monk under a tree on a hot day. They had paused for lunch. And while resting there, eating what they praised God, providing them with their food and the cool shade of the tree. Do we regularly thank God for the common gifts of God, which you and I are given every single day? Cortland Sayers, one starry night, began to consider his deep appreciation for the goodness of life, and he wrote these words, and I quote, 5,000 breathless dawns all new, 5,000 flowers fresh in dew, 5,000 sunsets wrapped in gold, 1,000,000 snowflakes served ice cold, 5 quiet friends, 1 baby's love, 1 white mad sea with clouds above, 100 music haunted dreams of moon drenched roads and hurrying streams, of prophesying winds and trees, of silent stars and drowsing bees, 1 June night in a fragrant wood, 1 heart that loved and understood. I wondered when I awoke at day how, in God's name, I could pay. Well, we couldn't possibly pay God for the abundance that he has given us, could we? We can only be grateful for them, and we can only remember to thank God throughout each day for God's mercy and goodness showered so liberally upon us. When John Wesley, which of course we all know is the founder of Methodism, when he was at Oxford University, he met a porter on the campus. He didn't have very much of the world's goods. Yet he amazed Wesley by his profound gratitude for what he did have. noticing the thinness of the man's old coat. Wesley asked about it. "This is the only coat I have," said the man, "and I thank God for it." Discovering that the man hadn't eaten much that day, Wesley was startled to hear the man say that even so, he was grateful to God for what he had been able to afford to eat. Wesley asked the man what else he was grateful for. The simple man answered these words, "I thank God for life, for a heart to love, and a desire to serve." His answer stayed with Wesley for the rest of his life. He had been deeply impressed by a man who practiced the holy habit of thanksgiving. The man had something, Wesley confessed, to which he had been a stranger. In his autobiography, Robert Morley, the English actor, has a statement worth considering when he says, "I'm not an introspective man, but I am, I hope, a grateful one. Life has treated me kindly, and should she suddenly withdraw her favors, I hope I shall always be mindful that for over 50 years, the sun shone on my back." That is the attitude of gratitude, an attitude each of us would do well to develop. Those who practice the holy habit of thanksgiving are persons who thank God regardless of what life deals them. Remember that Jesus was suffering, was offering thanksgiving to God there on the night before he was crucified. And it was the Old Testament prophet Habakkuk who said that even though his fig tree didn't blossom and his grape and olive crops failed and his sheep and his cattle died, nonetheless, he would rejoice in the Lord, Habakkuk 3:17. We can be thankful for adversity because we know that God still cares for us, and he will see us through to victory regardless of what comes. Even if we become sick unto death, we can praise God because we know that beyond the shadows of this earth, there is the light of eternity. Beyond death, there is eternal life. God will take us home with him. It is for that reason that we might well learn the prayer of Prayer de Foucault, which goes like this: "My Father, I abandon myself to you. Do with me what you will. And I thank you. I am prepared for anything." Basically, we can be grateful to God regardless of our circumstances, because even in the worst that befalls us, is an opportunity to grow a soul. It is trouble that can, if we will let it, help us grow spiritually. There was a woman named Shirley Reinhardt, and she wrote about how hardships and heavy burdens taught her to be responsible and strong. She told her irritating situations taught her the meaning of patience. She said that physical and mental pain had taught her to be compassionate with others. She said that physical and mental pain had taught her that. She went on to say that God has blessed me with failures, that I might be humble. He has placed me in difficult situations that have forced me to think and to grow in wisdom. I've experienced varied conflicts, and I've learned the value of peace. And then Shirley Reinhardt wrote this prayer: "God, I thank you for these blessings that so often come in disguise. Do not take from me anything that will help me grow in love. I ask for fresh assignments that may be difficult, new responsibilities in untried fields, and situations that demand all of my living and loving in this world. Amen." Shirley had learned the habit of thanksgiving. She has found the way to be joyous and grateful in spite of whatever comes into her life. we too will find that all of life becomes filled with meaning and joy when our hearts are grateful. When we thank God for the blessings and the opportunities and the challenges that every single day brings to us, let us faithfully begin to practice the holy habit of thanksgiving. I'd like to share an illustration with you that I've used several years ago, but I think it's very appropriate. There was a farmer with some puppies that he needed to sell. He painted a sign advertising the four pups and set about nailing it to a post at the edge of his yard. As he was driving the last nail into the post, he felt a tug on his overalls. He looked down into the eyes of a little boy. "Mister," he said, "I want to buy one of your puppies." "Well," said the farmer as he rubbed the sweat off the back of his neck, "these puppies come from fine parents and they cost a good deal of money." The boy dropped his head for a moment. And then reaching deep into his pocket, he pulled out a handful of change and held it up to the farmer. "I've got 39 cents. Is that enough to take a look?" "Sure," said the farmer. And with that, he let out a whistle. "Here, Dolly," he called. Out from the doghouse and down the ramp ran Dolly, followed by four little balls of fur. The little boy pressed his face against the chain-link fence. His eyes danced with delight. As the dogs made their way to the fence, the little boy noticed something else stirring inside of the doghouse. Slowly, another little ball appeared, this one noticeably smaller. Down the ramp it slid. Then, in a somewhat awkward manner, the little pup began hobbling toward the others, doing his best to catch up. "I want that one," the little boy said, pointing to the runt. The farmer knelt down at the boy's side and said, "Son, you don't want that puppy. He will never be able to run and play with you like these other dogs would." And with that, the little boy stepped back from the fence. He reached down and began rolling up one leg of his trousers. In doing so, he revealed a steel brace running down both sides of his leg, attached itself to a specially made shoe. Looking back up at the farmer, he said, "You see, sir, I don't run too well myself, and he will need someone who understands." With tears in his eyes, the farmer reached down and picked up the little pup. Holding it carefully, he handed it to the little boy. "How much?" asked the little boy. "No charge," asked the farmer. "There's no charge for love. The world is full of people who need someone who understands and loves." Let us pray. Lord, help us to have an understanding and loving heart. Help us to truly be grateful. For we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn today is 131, "We Gather Together." 131, let us stand as we are able.